Anyways, we are good people. Not always do we act good, but we're good people at heart. And at this special season, when we celebrate the birth of our Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who came in the world to be the light, to dispel the darkness of men's hearts, we thank you this morning that he's available to each and every person who would receive him. We ask you today to bless this meeting. May it bring honor and glory to thee. Thank you for friends who've gathered here from the community today and our folks from church. Father, bless now and have your way in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Please stand for a pledge of allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please be seated. Thank you. Our public speakers this morning, we have one person signed up. It's Mr. Tony Cox. Mr. Cox here.
I think he might have left.
Did he leave? He's in the back room? Okay, so he's come on his way. Cox, welcome, sir.
Again, Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to all.
Merry Christmas.
You know, I've been talking about the same thing up here for years, and it don't seem to be doing any good because meeting after meeting after meeting, people constantly telling me out there on the street the bad things that are being done to them in these enforcement schemes. But again, it don't matter until it becomes somebody that's connected that can get something done. When I come in here in 2007, the same thing should have been done that happened at the last meeting. There should have been apologies. No, there was things that was going on. You can listen to the tone of the meeting. Then people knew that it was wrong. And a lot of things happened on that one right there. A lot of things. When people in government investigate us, the people, there is a procedure. Judges, warrants, all this other stuff. But people have a fit when it's the federal government. But when spies in local government do what they do, and then those spies get up at this podium right here and they just lie, lie, lie with zero accountability. Zero. And I decided at that time, those people thought it was funny. But those people, they like to jump on old people, widow women, women that can't defend themselves, and people that lawyers will not defend them. Trumped up charges everywhere you look. Trumped up charges. You know, I'm not sure, but even in this room right here this morning, it looks like that is over occupancy. Dave Leonard used to stay on top of it, but if it's one of us, we are micromanaged. Micromanaged. But when one of y'all does something, it's okay. And it just continues to get worse and worse and worse and worse and worse. It used to be that other countries were the people that were doing things to destruct our country. But with big government and all these hirings and so forth, these new hires, they come in.
Thank you, Mr.
Cox. Just beat us down.
Thank you, Mr. Cox. All right. Any commissioners' responses? Public speaker. Hearing none. Approval of our agenda. I'd like to have the approval of the agenda with one amendment that we add the resolution for the Connect NC bond.
Make a motion to that.
All right, do I have a second?
I'll second it.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. It's approved.
Now I'm going to come down. I'm going to have to have Master Carter's assistance on this one.
I didn't do it.
You know, there's a man that's been hanging around and been busy doing the Lord's work and also doing the work of the citizens of Alamance County for 40 years now. Not only has he been doing that work, but all along the way, he's also, he and Mrs. Carter produced two fine children. And let me say, ladies and gentlemen, the fruit don't fall far from the tree. And the public service that you have done over the years, Pastor Carter, is greatly appreciated. I want to just go over a few things that you have done in your life. You served on several boards in Alamance County. Here's just a few of them, folks, to give you an idea. The Long Range Planning Committee, Mental Health, Social Services, Juvenile Crime Prevention, the Alamance County War Memorial. You, along with Mrs. Coy Justice, also helped put together the original list of names that are now listed in the Alamance War Memorial wall. And before the wall was erected, the reading of these names were read every Memorial weekend. And many attended these services, including congressmen, state senators, state representatives, county officials, and citizens who were related to the fallen. You were also invited to a luncheon with pastors at the White House by President Ronald Reagan. You were also invited to an open Congress in prayer in Washington, D.C., and was recognized publicly by Congressman Howard Coble and Senator Richard Burke. 9/11 came along, ladies and gentlemen, and with that, and the things we saw, we needed to remember. We needed to remember here in Alamance County. Well, Pastor Carter, you made sure that would always happen. Not only did you recognize the men and women that were killed tragically on 9/11, but also you recognize every single year the men and women that serve in those emergency capacities here in Alamance County.
Amen.
And with that being said, sir, I just want to thank you for your 40 years of service, you and your family. Now, I want you to turn around. You've got some family members here. You tell us who you've got here, sir, while I get something over here. Go ahead.
This is my son, David. I'm David's father. They used to ask me, who is your son? Now they say, who is your dad? Brenda's wife and Carson and Ryan and Mark and Susan and Jim and Melinda and Ed and Tim and Vicky and Walter and, sorry, sir. We had Judy and Josephus and Mark and Taylor and lying preacher back there and the Frasers and the Dices and you guys are under conviction. And over here, some of the Ron Gort, Ron Brown, and who were you yesterday?
Miss Linda's up there.
Where is Miss Linda?
How much did you got to do today?
Her mother turns 100 years today.
How about that?
They've got a citywide, statewide, national birthday. And then our photographer, she follows me around.
You also have a great passion and love for law enforcement.
Yes.
And with that being said, I'm going to ask our sheriff to come up. He has a few words he'd like to say to you.
I hope they're friendly.
You sure that was the Mental Health Board?
Many years ago, I attended Pastor Carter's church as a young man. He had a very, very big impact on me at that time. And as I grew older in law enforcement, much older, me and you both, Richard. Pastor Carter has carried the flag for law enforcement in this county. I can tell you, I know for 40 years, because that's been about how long I've known him. But every year, he and his church members that are here, they do a dinner for all the emergency personnel in this county. And if you've never been there, you need to see it, because hundreds of people come through and eat. And Pastor Carter has always been there, and I know for a fact he's done a lot of praying for me and the other officers in this county. And that's something that nobody can ever take away, Pastor. And I'm going to tell you this, you got a fine son and fine family and one heck of a wife. Because if I was her... That's all I can say for you. But I want to thank you on behalf of all the law enforcement in Alamance County for your service to the community, your service to God, and your service to us fellow officers.
Amen.
Proclamation thanking Reverend Pastor Donald R. Carter at Baptist Temple of Alamance County. Whereas Dr. Donald R. Carter is the pastor and founder of Baptist Temple of Alamance County since 1975. Whereas Pastor Carter has been a lifelong resident of Alamance County from the Alphalosophy community. And whereas the church is celebrating 40 years of service to the Alamance County community during the 2015 year. And whereas the church since 2001 has provided support for all countywide emergency personnel with honoring them annually during the 9/11 luncheon. And whereas Dr. Carter has provided leadership for Alamance County and its citizens in dealing with many issues that face our community. And whereas we would also like to recognize his wife, Betty, the 50 years.
Get up, honey.
And children, Lisa Raisey. Lisa was unable to be here today. Of Stokes County, and David Carter of Snow Camp. And now, be it therefore proclaimed by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners our great appreciation to Reverend Carter and the Baptist Temple of Alamance County for the continued support of all citizens of Alamance County, specifically our emergency personnel. We would also like to recognize and congratulate you on over 40 years of service to our community. From the Alamance County Commissioners, thank you very much, all of you.
In the mail.
Yes, sir. Thank you very much.
I'm very highly honored, and thank you not only for myself, but our folks who worked so hard to make the 9/11 meal a possibility. It is a fabulous thing. They do it with joy. They do it with heart. They do it because they appreciate what you guys do for us. We could not do it without their participation. We have noticed over the years that we've had to cook more and more. We have noticed that some of you have gotten larger. Next year, we're going to vegetarian diet. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Carter. At this time, folks, if you're glad to stay with us, or if you'd like to be dismissed, you may go. We're going to probably have about another hour and a half of meetings.
See, he's doing something you don't do. He let him out early today.
Thank you for being here, folks.
David, you don't need it.
Next, we have a young lady who is retiring from the Alamance County Department of Social Services with 30 years of service. Her name is Linda Allison. And at this time, I'd like to call on Miss Susan Osborne.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Come on up, Miss Allison. So, as a
part of the retirement and honoring Linda, Craig Honeycutt and myself and the commissioners felt it would be important for us to call our governor and say that you had done an exemplary service in Alamance County. So a nomination was entered, and this is what it said. Linda has committed her career and her life to serving the citizens of Alamance County. She began her service at DSS in 1984 and has worked in all programs of our agency. She progressed from an employee in food and nutrition to deputy director during her tenure at Alamance County DSS. She's worked locally and across the state as a champion to ensure that vulnerable elderly population are protected from abuse, neglect, and exploitation. She, for many years, has coordinated the social services response for disaster shelters, particularly focusing on our elderly and special needs citizens. Linda served on many state task force, local boards, and advisory committees. She has been a mentor to young workers, a passionate advocate for our citizens, and a loyal public service to Alamance County government. She's impacted the lives of thousands as she has assisted in the provision of services in our agency. And we thank you. And so, our...
Now, I have something for you here, but I think you've got some people here with you today.
I do.
Why don't you ask them to come forward
sure.
right now? And,
I'd like to ask my husband, Monty, and my daughter, Natalie. I have a daughter who lives about 5 hours away and is not able to be here.
I'd like to serve as a photographer, though.
Oh, that's a reporter in you.
My husband, Monty.
Monty, welcome, sir. Yes, sir. Governor Pat McCrory has recognized Linda Allison for her outstanding service to the state of North Carolina by issuing the State of North Carolina Cardinal Award that we see here. This is the State of North Carolina Cardinal Award issued by Pat McCrory, Governor. Presented Linda Allison in recognition of dedication and outstanding service as an exemplary employee of the great state of North Carolina, where the weak grow strong and the strong grow weak. Great is the motto. And the strong grow great. Audience live. But Linda, we just want to thank you for the outstanding new job, and you will be sorely missed. But I know Susan's going to miss you, but thank you for a great job. Well done.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
So appreciate Chairman Engel, Commissioners, Mr. Honeycutt, my director, Susan. Thank you all so very much for your support over the years. When I was told about this award, I have to tell you, I was in utter shock. I feel like there's so many other much more deserving individuals than myself, but I can honestly say I've worked with many of you for lots of years, and it's been a true passion for me to work with, as Susan said, the most vulnerable in our county through our work with DSS, and I just thank God for that opportunity. I said it never was really a job for me, and that's the truth. Talk to this man. I drag him into lots of things over the years. But it has truly been a life assignment that I have taken very passionately, and I thank each of you citizens and everyone for this opportunity, and especially this lady standing beside of me. I fondly call her boss, and that is fondly, and that is what I call her. But you have no idea what this lady's meant and the way she's mentored me, and I stand here today because of her, and I appreciate that.
We thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Back a couple months ago, we had a information from Judge Smith, Commissioner Smith, that there's a possibility that we may be able to secure some property. This centrally located here in Alamance County, that would be very it would be an outstanding place for us to have to continue on with property adjacent to property that we already have. and that there were some partners that were willing to turn that property over to the county. And it just so happened those were the folks from Cronodal Clinic, the partners at Cronodal Clinic. Judge, I just thank you for bringing that to us. And but most of all, I just ask the partners if they'd come forward at this time, those that are here. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Dr. Knoll, good to see you. Mike, Dr. Knoll, Mike Lunsford, it's good to have you here today. But we'd just like to thank you on behalf of the county and the citizens. It's going to be a tremendous savings. It's a strategic place for us as we look at our plan and you know, for the infrastructure and buildings. And we just thank you for that. And on behalf of that, I have this proclamation thanking the Cronodal Clinic for its support of Alamance County and its citizens. Whereas in 1949, the first Cronodal Clinic was opened at Graham Hopedale Road to provide basic health care for the citizens of Alamance County. And whereas the Cronodal Clinic has been in continuous operation in Burlington since this beginning, employing over 130 physicians during this period who have been an integral part of the history of Alamance County, from mayors to board of commissioners members. And whereas the Cronodal Clinic currently employs 49 physicians and 20 mid-level providers across 15 different specialties. And whereas Cronodal Clinic gives exemplary health care currently to over 55,000 patients, provides over 200,000 patient encounters in their three Alamance County offices and over 7,000 surgery procedures at Alamance Regional Medical Center. And whereas in December of 2015, the clinic donated to Alamance County the Cronodal Clinic Easttown across from Alamance County's current human services, with a building having over 24,000 square feet on approximately 1.5 acres and having a tax value of approximately $1.4 million. Now be it therefore proclaimed by the Alamance County Board of Commissioners our appreciation to the Cronodal Clinic for its recent property donation to Alamance County, along with providing health care and leadership to Alamance County and its citizens for the past 65 years. This 21st day of December 2015, Alamance County Commissioners. Thank you, thank you, thank you for this generous gift. We certainly appreciate it.
Thank you very much. Represent our founders, two of whom are still living, Dr. Charles Cronodal and Dan Wiggins, our original administrator. And they're very proud of this, and so are we. The real winner here, or the real person to thank, or the people to thank, in my opinion, are the citizens of Alamance County who supported the clinic all these years. And we're very delighted to be able to participate in this.
Thank you, Doctor. Thank we you appreciate it. Thank you. Thank you.
Back on to our agenda, the consent agenda. Members, any items to be pulled from the consent agenda? Hearing none, I have a motion of approval of the consent agenda.
So move.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Next, we have a public hearing on Alamance Foods. Mr. Honeycutt.
I'll introduce Mac Williams, who will give the basic background.
Thank you, Craig. Commissioners, I'm happy to be here this morning to introduce the owner and of Alamance Foods and the gentleman he's working with, the developer, who will introduce the project and answer your questions and the questions the public may have about it. Been delighted to work with these folks for the last couple of months as they evaluate their options, and glad to be going down the path that we're hopefully going down this morning. I'm going to introduce to you the president of Alamance Foods. Bill Scott Jr. is here, but the person that's going to come up and go through the project details with you is Buddy Seymour, who is the principal with a development company called Windsor Commercial. Buddy is a experienced guy who's been, I've known Buddy for many, many, many decades, and enjoyed working with him on this project. So I'm going to ask at this time Buddy Seymour to come forward to talk about the project.
Right. Welcome, Mr. Seymour.
Good morning. Good morning, Chairman, Commissioners. I am Buddy Seymour with Windsor Commercial.
We're a Greensboro-based commercial development and construction company, and I've been having the pleasure of working with Bill Scott over the last several months regarding this project. And we will kind of go through some slides in a minute, but just as a form of introduction, we've been working on this for quite a while. We've done a multi-county search trying to find either a facility that's existing or a site that was appropriate for providing the type of facility to enhance Alamance Foods business. We found no buildings in the area that we searched, which is an indication that the market is definitely different than it was several years ago. But we did identify 8 potential sites. We did some preliminary layouts on those 8 sites, narrowed it down to 3 sites. Those 3 sites, we actually did layouts and grading plans and have identified the site we're going to talk about today as a preferred site based on what we know at this point in time. We've actually done some preliminary building design, some elevations, and in September we put this property under contract with a time period enough to go through the final, hopefully, analysis and financial modeling to support moving forward with the project. And we're still in that process, but this is an important part of that. We have had meetings with the planners over in Burlington. We have confirmed that the site is zoned appropriately, utilities appear to be adequate, and that would be a good fit for what we're trying to do. We still need final review, as in all other projects, like we would go through with this. We have conducted phase one surveys, phase two surveys. We've done borings, we've done topo, we've done wetland delineation, and we're still in the process of compiling all that information and making sure that we have the right analysis of that. But all that work is underway, and we look forward to presenting some of those findings as we go through this. The site that we're talking about is at 1136 Cedar Crest Drive, more popularly known as the former Hanford Brick site. It has a location next to Kaiseroth and is what we'll be talking about a little bit more. Just as a little background, and Bill can certainly add to this later on if you have any questions, but Alamance Food started in 1959, but it really grew out of other family-owned businesses that have been a proud part of Alamance County for over 100 years. But in 1959, Alamance Foods was started. Their primary business lines today are aerosol whipped cream, freeze pops, flavored drinks, and bottled water. And they're actually a national manufacturer for the aerosol whipped cream and freeze pop markets. The project we're talking about today is specifically to support the freeze pop business that they operate in multiple facilities in the area. What we're proposing today is construct a new facility that would allow them to consolidate some of the operations that are housed in multiple facilities that they own and multiple facilities that they lease on short-term basis to handle their inventory and logistics. And as the industrial market has changed over the last several years, the space that they utilize in the lease form has been more and more difficult to achieve and has driven them to the decision to move forward with the facility. The first phase of this operation would actually involve a 500,000 square foot industrial building. That's a very large building. It would be built to today's industrial standards so that it did not have a short life but a long life in terms of meeting needs for the operation as it's known today and what we would anticipate it to be. The first phase would be just strictly for warehousing and distributing the product. Future phases would involve moving the production of the freeze pops into that facility, and we'd have the capability of adding on over 235,000 square feet to that facility. Whether it was for the growth of the freeze pops industry, another business within Alamance Foods, or another business that might be a venture with someone else that was compatible to their operation. Again, the proposed site is a 52-acre site over off of Cedar Crest Drive. As I mentioned, the zoning utilities are adequate. But that facility was used in the production of brick for over 60 years. They mined clay out of part of the site, brought it up to the front where they had a 150,000 square foot production facility. And that operated all the way up to the early 2000s. The site is challenged for redevelopment, though, because of the way that facility was operated and for the times that it was operated. There were environmental geotechnical issues that we have continued to evaluate And we would plan on applying for the North Carolina Brownfields Program as part of the overall project development. This is an aerial view of the site as it is today. It's a little hard to see, but it is outlined in red. And it sits next to the Kaiserall facility. If you go out there today, there's an office building that was constructed that would remain. The original plant has been demolished with the exception of some blow walls and a portion of the slab still in place. And there are three auxiliary buildings over here that have been used for storage. The mining operation took place back in this portion of the property. And they operated trucks, vehicles, they had storage tanks for fuel and four or five locations on site that used solvents in the process. And there was debris that was used to backfill the areas where the mining took place. But that's the site as it is today.
Mr. Seymour, could you orient us to where the interstate is?
Okay, I'm sorry. This is I-40, I-85 right here.
There it is.
Yep. And that's the Kaiserall, which is undergoing an expansion at this time. I'm sorry, jumps through that.
I look at it a million times a day.
I know. Okay, everybody. This is Hanford Road. This is Cedar Crest Drive, and this is the service road.
Yeah, hit that high there.
Okay.
The layout that we're proposing at this time, to provide you some additional information. This is I-85, I-40 right here.
There you go.
This is the Kaiserall facility. What you have outlined in bold there is a 500,000 square foot industrial building. It is cross-dock, meaning that there are docks located on both sides of the facility since this is being used heavily for distribution. That is critical. It does show this additional area of 235,000 square feet. Over the first few years of operation, we would expect to bring into the production process somewhere within this facility, but it's a little too early to say exactly how that would work out. We'd be utilizing existing drive here to bring truck traffic in. We would relocate a drive here to bring in the parking for employees. We're evaluating whether we would use this northern drive for truck exit or potentially a drive on the Hanford Road. But that is an overview. To give you a little bit of order of magnitude or a better feel for that, we've put this on top of an aerial photograph. So as you go out there today, you can see the back end of the Kaiserall plant. The existing office building sits right there in that corner. You can see the leftover slab from the plant that's been there through some partial demolition. These are existing buildings here. But that this building footprint goes over what was part of this debris land to fill area, which is located right in here. And they operated their facility. And this was some brick storage back in this portion of the property. And I believe this was a drive where they ran their delivery trucks out at some time. That's a pretty good overview of the facility that we have planned. The impact of this will be a $16 million investment by Alamance Foods for the development of the site and construction of the building. This would all be new tax base for the community. It would not take away from any of the current operations that Alamance Food has. It would simply be an expansion of that for them. This would probably be the largest capital investment they've ever made at one point in time in their history. While we don't know what the future job growth is specifically, we would anticipate that there'd be at least 30 additional employees as the production area was moved over. And there'll probably be another $5 million of investment related to production equipment, but that is not part of this request. So this will be expansion of the tax base and local support for Alamance Foods operations. And that really concludes my prepared comments. Appreciate your consideration and support for this, and Bill and I would be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you. Gentlemen, before we take comments, this is a public hearing, but I will need a motion that we go into public hearing at this time. Do I have that motion?
Motion to go into public hearing.
I'll take a second.
Second.
Those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Now for questions.
I have a question. You mentioned, though, that you're consolidating operations in
yes.
this new building, but it's not. It doesn't mean that any of the existing facilities are closing.
That's right.
That tax base is going to remain the same. So this is all additional.
This is all new. That's correct. Yeah, the real estate property that they own and operated in would remain the same. They would be vacating leased facilities, but those facilities will remain. and hopefully they'll free up space within their existing facilities to, you know, improve their operation and have future growth.
And we do have that in our agreement, that it is for new taxable and not any consolidation. Specifically, it states in Section 5, the investment may not be achieved by reduction, transfers of capacity, or offset in other manufacturing facilities owned by the company. So what we're looking for is
new investment.
Investment. Yes, sir.
Thank you.
And the reason that is important, as you look at these economic incentives, even with the incentive that if this passes today, the company, Alamance Foods, will still be paying about $20,000 per year in taxes above and beyond that and beginning. So, you know, that's a win-win situation, ladies and gentlemen. It takes a lot of houses to make, you know, make $20,000. So it's, you know, in essence, it is a win for the taxpayers as we look at that.
Mr. Chairman, yes. What we're looking at is a $64,000 to be paid over a five-year period, but the annual taxes that would be generated off of the $16 million would be $92,800.
That's exactly what I just calculated.
Oh, okay.
Just right.
So my math is right.
Well, I think we're better than 20.
Oh, okay.
All 64 right. to 92 is...
That sounds better. That sounds better.
It's even better.
I got you.
Well, and looking at this, I see that you said that you're not guaranteeing jobs, but I don't see how you open a facility of that size with adding workforce to accommodate what's got to be done on that property.
Well, there's a lot of employees that are scattered around the city at this point in time, and we hopefully would be able to consolidate. You do add efficiency during that process, but
right.
We still anticipate growth at this point.
I've got a question for the realtor out here because I know Jeff very well. And how long has that property been on the market, Jeff? And tax value of that property was
about 1.2,
so we're adding a huge base to that. From a realtor point of view, I like to see what we're doing on the ground because that building means a whole lot.
I have some fond memories of that property, Jeff. The sheriff took me over there back years ago. He said we can really get in shape and lose weight by moving bricks out of the kiln, that day they were moving the large bricks, so after about an hour and a half, I'd lost about 13 pounds, and I passed out in there. They had to carry me out of there. It's good to see that property coming back in use. It really is.
Yes,
and,
it is.
I
hate it's not a brick manufacturer. I'll be honest, being a builder here, I'd love to see another Camford brick over there.
I know. I've tried that myself.
Okay, this is a public hearing. Does anybody on this side of the room have any questions for the commissioners or folks here from Alamance Foods? Seeing none, I'll move to this side. Any folks on this side? All right, seeing none, I'll, at this time,
Mr. Chairman, we do have a couple of people in the back.
All right, no, I'll wait and see.
They need to move up here, I think.
Mr. Brown, could you check and see if there's anybody in the back who'd like to speak on this?
And ask them to come
I'll
up
move
here.
To the back in the meantime.
Thank you.
Here we go.
I don't guess we have anybody.
I guess not.
I'll wait for Mr. Brown to get back. Nobody.
Okay.
All right. Do I have a motion that we close the public hearing at this time?
Motion to close.
A second.
Second.
All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. All right. I'll entertain a motion at this time. Or any further discussion?
Move approval.
Move approval.
Second.
Motion second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. Next, we have the resolution expressing support for Connect NC bond. I'm sorry, Mr. Wilkins.
Just
I'm sorry.
Take a break, then.
That's item number 9, where it says presentations. I apologize. We still need to do that. Dr. Gabriel, welcome, sir.
Good morning, yes, Mr. Chairman. Good morning, members of the
Commission.
Also
see you have staff here. Ms. Colley, good
that's
to see you
correct.
Today.
Yeah. Ms. Colley is the Vice President for Administrative Services at the college.
Good to have you back today.
So in the event we get into some details regarding questions, she's here to help me answer them. So the North Carolina, thank you so much for hearing me this morning.
Yes,
I really appreciate it.
Yes,
I think this is an opportunity for Anson, Alamance County, as well as counties across the state, ranging from Anson to Onslow and so on. Connect North Carolina is a $2 billion, that's with a B, billion-dollar bond proposal for strategic investments in North Carolina's public infrastructure, higher education, parks, agriculture, safety, water and sewage. And the whole purpose of this is just to make us more economically sound as a state. It's been a number of years since the state has presented a statewide bond measure, and I think our time is past due. Now, there are several good points about this bond measure. One is that it does not require any new taxes. They will finance the bonds essentially like financing a house over time, and it's my understanding that these bonds will be paid in some 20 to 25 years. And North Carolina doesn't have a lot of debt, is what I also understand. The projects span from the mountains to the coast. They include every community college in North Carolina, and they include the university system. I am more interested in the community colleges. There would be $350 million for the 58 community colleges. The projects will range from $2.8 million to a high of $12.5 million at Wake Community College. The average amount of the bonds available to a given community college would be around $6,034,000. Alamance Community College will receive $6.1 million, so just slightly above average. And there are some specific variables used to compute how an amount that each institution would receive, and it has to do with things about wealth of the county, size of the institution, the square feet of existing facilities, the type of projects, and college priority. And that just really puts us right in the middle, almost any way you spin it. Now, just for information, I would like to share with you what the university system would get out of this, as well as some of the other entities that are poised to receive a significant amount. The UNC system will receive $980 million. Their projects will range from $10 million to a high of $110 million. And that's kind of tricky, because over and above all of that, NC State would receive $90 million for agriculture plant science research complex, and $94 million for a lab at the Agriculture and Consumer Sciences Building for veterinary food, drug, motor test, food testing, and so on. Parks and state parks will receive $75 million. The National Guard facility will receive a $70 million. North Carolina will also invest in its water and sewage infrastructure to the tune of $309.5 million. And then, of course, I just mentioned agriculture and research, $85 and $94 million, respectively. So this is essentially what this bond will do. The community colleges play a major role in investing in the economic viability of the state. We provide job training and education, and I understand that in terms of looking at us, in comparison to other community colleges across the nation, we're pretty good at it. We are the envy of many states and many other schools, and this will help us to kind of maintain that position. What will it do for Alamance Community College? Of course, as I said, $6.1 million. But it will take some of the stress off of the county. It will take some of the stress off of Sidney Colley and myself and others who worry about, you know, how we'll pay for all of this deferred maintenance and the other infrastructure capital needs that we have. And we you know, I hate to say this, but we hate to have to keep coming back to you, but we will. So don't be
count on it.
Don't be misled by that statement. We will be back.
This is a reprieve.
Exactly. Another good thing about this bond is, although we submit it to the state how we would use the funds, we have flexibility. And I can assure you that our Building and Grounds Committee and our board will look deeply at, you know, what makes the best sense for this county. How can we get the best benefit of the dollars available? But as it stands now, here are some possibilities in priority order. And one is to expand our health sciences building, to graduate more people in the healthcare professionals, and to renovate or repurpose space vacated by those programs that will occupy the new Advanced Applied Technology building. That is a must-do. We have to renovate those properties, facilities, so that we can continue to make good use of them. And then lastly, to ensure state-of-the-art classrooms and labs so that we can stay on the cutting edge in terms of teaching and learning. So that is pretty much what the bond measure will do, and I hope that you will support this by adopting the resolution. We anticipate getting other key organizations in the county to also consider adopting the resolution. Of course, our board is poised to adopt the same resolution in January when they meet. That's my presentation.
Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. And let me say that this should have been on the agenda instead of being added this morning, but the chairman of the Board of Commissioners had a senior moment and didn't get it to the county manager, so that's the reason it was added this morning, and I apologize for that. That being said, it's, each one of the commissioners had the opportunity to read this resolution.
I have.
All right, any questions of Dr. Gatewood?
Well, my question, I guess, for the public, where can they go to get these numbers that you presented to us? I know somebody sent me a link to the NC Connect bond, mm-hmm. and on my iPad, you had to turn sideways to look at it. Wouldn't, for some reason, the layout wasn't there. But are these numbers coming in from the state? Is that
yes? They are from the state.
If you connect to the NC,
it's this
Connect bond,
right, and go to the house, the appropriate house bill, and then all of this information is
okay,
embedded,
so it will
in
be
that
in
house
there,
bill.
The breakdown in the numbers. Okay.
Yes.
Because I had one guy sent me a thing on Facebook, because I put it out there, you know, liked it, and
right.
He said, well, I had to look at it sideways, and I still couldn't find how much money Alamance Community College was getting. And I think that's important to the citizens if
it
we
is.
Ask them to step up and vote for this in March, which is coming up. So.
March 15, it will be on the ballot, and it'll be a very simple yes and no.
Exactly. And when was the last bond, Craig? Do you know offhand that the state did? 2000 it's been
a long time.
It was 2000.
Yeah, so, and I think the governor and the
15 years
legislators worked that out so that you wouldn't have that tax increase for the citizens, and I think that's very important. Go ahead.
Well, I just want to say, I think it's paramount that we support this, and it's paramount for our county and for our state, and we just need to keep investing in our state, and we're going to benefit directly through the community college, but we'll benefit indirectly at the very least through all the investments that are being made elsewhere across the state that really help our state's economy, which helps us.
Yeah. And we're at a record low on interest rates, which is critical because from looking at the markets and everything, I think the next 2 years we're going to see that interest rate climb. We're going to get a lot more for our money.
And just to reiterate something that Dr. Gatewood said, is that if you look at the debt payment, we have the money now to pay for that debt service with the state. So with the growth that we've seen in sales tax, that there is funding available without new taxes.
Any further questions?
Yep.
I'll entertain a motion at this
time.
I'll make a motion
that we accept the resolution.
Right here, second.
I'll second it.
Motion second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gatewood. Thank you, Ms. Collin. Appreciate it. Next, we have Ms. Wilkerson. Welcome. we're fine, ma'am. Request to pursue radio frequency identification tag.
Yes, sir. One of the new technologies, although it's not so new anymore, many libraries put in place is something called radio frequency identification tagging, and it's the shortened form RFID. We would like to pursue putting out requests for proposals for vendors to send us their proposals for implementing this RFID project. It will make our processes a lot more efficient, because right now staff and public has to check out one book at a time. With RFID, we tag each item and they can place a stack up to a certain height, and all of them get read by the computer and checked out. So it will help us with staff efficiency. It'll help the patrons have a better self check experience when they come in. We've been sort of stockpiling money in our donations. We got a heavy donation a year and a half ago that we set aside because we've been wanting to do this project for a while. So we've been saving up our money to do that, and now with the performance measurement project money savings that we get, we can use some of that to add to it.
What's the normal cost for vendors?
It will range anywhere from $200,000 to $300,000 for the project, because there's equipment involved, there are the tags, we have to put a special antenna in every single book. Every single DVD will have a tag on it. We have to get the security gates that work with the system. We'll have antenna, what they call antenna pads, at each checkout station that the books go on. The big cost will be the self-check kiosks that will allow patrons to bring a stack of books up and check them out. And so we'll start out with the minimum self-checks and pieces of equipment, and we can add those later on as we get more funding for it.
Okay. How much money do we have?
I figured out that we had about $250,000 in my donations line item, my 810 item.
Okay, so you got the money to pay for it.
I have the money to pay for it.
It's there.
Susan's been saying, and Jay, you guys spend your money, guys. And I'm like, trust me, I'm saving it for something. We had a very generous donation about a year and a half ago of over $100,000. And I just set that aside because this is something that I've really been wanting. And most public libraries in the state and in the country already have this in place. So we're one of the few that doesn't, and I've been tucking it away here and there.
And saving your pennies.
Exactly.
To get there, right?
Exactly.
This will be for all the libraries.
It will be for all the libraries, yes, sir.
Okay. All right. I make a motion that we approve this.
Right. Any further discussion? I'll second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you.
Next, we have the annual audit presentation.
We're going to call, come on up, Brian.
Hi, Brian.
Brian with the big book.
Good morning, Chairman and members of the board. My name is Brian Lackey with Martin Starnes and Associates, and the county's independent auditors, and I'm here to talk to you a little bit today about your 2015 audited financial statements. We issued an unqualified opinion on the county's financial statements, which is the cleanest opinion that we can issue. I would like to thank Susan, Andrea, and all the staff in the finance department for being well prepared, very well prepared, and very easy to work with. I know it can be a stressful time when we come in and we bug them for a couple weeks out of the year, and just would like to say thank you for them. And the county did also implement GASB 68, which is a new pension standard. You'll see some new footnotes, and you'll see some new line items and in your financial statements for these. A summary of your general fund: the county had revenues of $133,099,484 in 2015, compared to $128,300,316 in 2014. And expenditures in 2015 of $130,387,257 compared to $125,636,910 in 2014. The county's general fund balance increased by roughly $7 million in the current year. Most of that was due to a sale of a couple pieces of property that you will see broken out on the financial statements when you do receive those. The county's available fund balance that's calculated by the LGC, it takes your total fund balance of your general fund, takes out your non-spendable items, which are your inventories and things that are not in cash form, and your stabilization by state statute to come to your available fund balance number. So the county's available fund balance for the general fund, we take the total fund balance of the general fund of $38,467,180 and take out the stabilization by state statute of the $8,769,384 to come to the county's total available fund balance of $29,697,796, which is an increase from prior year of about $7 million. It was $24,374,298 in 2014. Now, your available fund balance as a percentage of the total general fund expenditures in the current year is roughly 22.8, which is an increase from 2014 of 19.4. County's Enterprise Fund Landfill Fund had operating income of $898,265 compared to $539,205 in 2014. The county's investment in capital assets for 2015, $13,523,183 compared to $13,348,938. And your unrestricted net position in the landfill fund was $7,928,221 compared to $7,292,012 in 2014, bringing your total net position for the landfill fund to $21,451,404, which is an $810,000 increase from prior year. Are there any questions?
Questions?
The increase in expenditures from 2014 to 2015. Was there $5 million?
For the general fund?
Right.
Yes. From 1.56 to 134.
There was an increase in federal funding in the current year, which is a wash. You received more money from federal and state programs at DSS. It was across the board. All the counties did receive this money, so it was a wash. Your revenues and your expenditures both increased in the current year for that.
To match.
Correct.
So the sale of the property isn't in?
The sale of the property is in the revenues of the $133,099,484.
And how much was that? It was
the sale of the property?
Yeah,
3.9.
That was
the So going from 128 to 133, $4 million of that is because of the sale of property.
Correct.
Not the increase in the government grants.
And your sales tax also increased in the current year as well. There is a large increase in sales tax, about $3 million of that as well.
Okay, so then, but we had a similar amount increase in expenses. So it couldn't all be because of matching grants.
Correct. And you also did buy some property in the current year. There were capital asset expenditures in the current year as well, causing for the increase.
So that includes capital.
Correct.
That interest too.
Okay. Any further comments or questions?
Seems like that's a pretty good report.
It's a very good report, and do want to thank Susan and her staff and for the work they've done. And again, to be at 22.4% is a great testament to our staff and to this board and the decisions that were made. If you remember, probably 4 years ago, 5 years ago, we were at 7.8%.
And then what is the average or the median of the counties of our size, their percent of
I don't have that information with me. It would be comparing 2014 information. It's a year in arrears for that.
You think it's moved very much in a year?
As far as the average, probably not. I can send you the link that the state treasurer, on the state treasurer's website, there's a LGC memo every year that comes out that compares you guys, and it shows the average fund balance percentages to of Alamance County comparing to counties similar size.
I know Susan keeps up with.
She probably last year, I believe it was around 24%.
24. It was around 24.
Is that counties our size, basically?
Mm-hmm. So we don't know what it is for 2015 yet.
Right. Okay. Probably won't be available till about April or May for the LGC memo.
So we're close anyways. We ought to be pretty close.
Yeah. We're getting
very close.
Okay. All right. Any further questions, comments?
Nope.
Thank you, Brian.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Thank you,
Susan.
Thank you. Need a motion to approve.
Mr. Chairman,
we did a motion. All right. I have a motion to approve the audit as presented.
I'll make that motion.
Second.
All right. Motion second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
Appreciate
Thanks.
It.
Thank you, Brian.
Next, we have position request, Robert Key, Director of Inspections. Welcome, Robert.
Good morning.
Good morning, sir.
Been a little while since I've been up here.
Yes, sir.
I wanted, first of all, thank you, Chairman Engel, and you commissioners, for your service to the community. We appreciate what you do. I'm here to ask for the position that I mentioned at budget time. I mentioned that we were down a position. At that time, I had no idea how busy we would have been through the summer and even continuing now through this time. If you've looked at the presentation, the proposal I sent, you can see that all of our numbers are up very significantly just compared with a year ago, and of course hugely compared with the time of the downturn in 2010, 2011, when many building inspectors were taking nursing classes and becoming truck drivers. We never got that slow in Alamance County and never had to lay anyone off, so that's great. We did eliminate a position in 2014, and now we are at a point where we are regularly exceeding the capacity. The North Carolina Department of Insurance recommends no more than 20 inspections per day per inspector. You can imagine how difficult it would be to drive to inspect, write out, post, perhaps discuss, to do 20, and we're regularly seeing numbers in the mid-20s for all of our staff. This time of year, when normally it slows down quite a bit and we try to get our continuing education done that's required, we were all flabbergasted at how busy we still are right now. A day like today where I've got an inspector out sick and one on vacation, my guys, they're well beyond that recommended capacity. So for that reason, and the fact that the services that we provide are important, they're mandated by the state, I'm asking for an additional position. I want you to know that I don't take that request lightly. All of our staff works hard and likes to work hard. I have taken plan review off of the inspectors and taken it on myself just because they just don't get back in soon enough to really do anything in the afternoon. Additionally, House Bill 255 has a provision for inspections being done in a timely manner. We have a great reputation in the community of doing a next day inspection, and we're getting to the point where if we even just stay this busy in the spring, it's going to be very difficult to maintain that. The National Association of Home Builders is forecasting a 27% increase beyond what we did this past year for next year. And I think in Alamance County, we're uniquely positioned because of our low tax rate, available property at a decent price, and other factors being between two growth areas. I think we're going to be beyond the national average. I think we're going to see an extremely busy year next year. So I want to be ready for that. I don't want to be in a position where we're behind trying to play catch up. It creates problems and ill will in the community, and it impacts the quality of what we do. What we do directly affects building safety and building quality in our community. So I hope you'll consider my request. Again, I say I'm not making this lightly, not just because I think I can. We genuinely need the extra person. Does anyone have any questions about the position? Or
I'll just make a comment. I hadn't heard any complaints from the builders so far. So
thank you.
I usually am a front line for that, being in the home builders. But I do realize what you're saying, and everything I've read, where things are ramping up. I think Alamance County is poised for quite a bit of growth through the next year, and next 2 or 3 years, actually. Mm. And I think it's good because builders, to them, an extra day of waiting is money.
Oh, absolutely.
And we don't like to waste money because we can't get that inspector out there. So I think it's our obligation as a board here to help facilitate that.
October, we had just dwellings starts was 81 mm-hmm. in October. So which was a significant increase from, I think, from the prior month. And looking at that, I know Ms. Saunders and I, we had, Craig had a discussion about environmental. And when you're short an employee or you've got one in training, it can make a significant difference in going out and doing these inspections, and which was the case in our environmental. So, you know, that's something certainly to think about. And business is picking up.
It is.
As you said, we're seeing more housing starts and other things.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I have a budget question, and maybe Susan can help answer it if you can't, Robert. So we have a budget for the current fiscal year, and so this is an additional person to what you originally budgeted, correct?
Mm-hmm.
But,
yes.
But we also budget revenue,
right,
you know, with fees. Yeah, so,
yes.
And I know that you indicated from November of last year through November of this year, but I was wondering how it was tracking from July 1st of this year to the current time period. And is our revenues over our budget significantly, at least to the extent of this increment?
I don't have hard numbers with me. I'd be glad to pull those out of the computer for you. Wouldn't be that difficult to do, but just informally, I can tell you, yes, very significant increase. The revenues are there. Another portion of House Bill 255 clarifies that we are actually required to spend our revenues on the department.
Yeah.
We can't take our inspection revenues and spend them on, you know, somebody else's stuff.
Kind of like the landfill. They can't go spend right. their, we can't go get their money, even
right.
though it's.
But our revenues are up very, very significantly.
Bob, it's close to probably $200,000 that our revenue's up over last year.
For the 5 months? Around five months. Oh, you mean?
Well, not for the 5 months, but
for 1 year.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, and it shows this.
Yeah.
All right.
But I could get that information for you.
Over recent months.
Be glad to get it for you and email it to you.
And I guess if we're having more activity, like you said, they must be
up.
Be up, yeah.
So it's.
The offset for revenue for his budget amendment, you can utilize those revenues that are coming in versus using appropriated fund balance.
Right.
Yeah, it looked, I can get the specific figures, but it looked like there was certainly adequate revenue to cover the cost of the position, which I included in the proposal.
Yeah. Further questions, comments?
I'd like to make a motion that we approve this position.
All right. Yeah, motion, do I have a second?
I'll second it.
A motion is second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes, sir. Thank you. Next, we have item number four, the adoption of the 2016 Alamance County Board of Commissioners regular meeting schedule. Any comments or questions on that? If hearing none, I'll entertain a motion at this time.
Make a motion that we approve next year's meetings.
I'll second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. And then we, members, if you've had the opportunity to look over the committee assignments, there's only one change. We can certainly open it up for discussion, but Ms. Massey's had some health problems, and so I added myself on the DSS board as an alternate. Any problems with that from anybody or questions about that? Yeah. Other than that, that's the only change. Any other comments or questions?
Well, I noticed that you have your activity on the NCACC Board of Directors.
Yes, sir.
I don't know if it needs to be put on here, but I'm not now a member of the Health and Human Services Committee of the North Carolina Association of County Commissioners.
Not really outside. These are our
board
appointed positions by the chairman.
Right.
So outside, I think we're okay.
Right.
Yes,
okay. All right. Any further discussion, comments? All right.
And Mr. Chairman, also just from, we have now added the transportation committee that we did not have last year that Bob is now serving on.
Right. Okay. All right. Any other comments, questions? I'll make a motion that we approve the committee assignments. Do I have a second?
Second.
All right. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, no. Thank you, gentlemen. Budget amendments. Budget amendment for the Sheriff's Department, Susan Roberts. Welcome, Susan.
Good morning, Commissioners. As you'll recall, at the last Commissioners meeting, the sheriff asked for two corporal positions, and the budget amendment that I'm bringing before you now is to add to his budget $111,386, and that would come from appropriated fund balance to fund those two positions.
All right. Any questions of Susan?
Motion to approve.
Motion. I have a second.
Second.
Motion second. All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you. Thank you, Susan.
You're welcome. I think I've got the next.
You got another one. Yeah.
Before you this morning also is to ask that we be able to budget $9,911 from appropriated fund balance to repay the state for an overpayment in their Medicaid cost report.
All right.
I'll make the motion to approve that.
Second.
Right. Motion second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, no.
Thank you.
Thank you. Next, we have Mr. Albright, budget amendment for the defense of the DOJ appeal. Welcome.
A terrible cold this morning, so I'm bear
you, bear you'll find out where you are.
I come before you this morning to ask for additional funding. The sheriff, of course, everybody knows we won the lawsuit, but the Fourth Circuit Court of Appeals has a mediation program. We are engaged with the mediator now in an attempt to get the federal government to recognize that we won and settle the thing without having to go before the Fourth Circuit. Okay. And that's what this funding is about. I'm not saying I'm going to spend all $35,000, but I just want enough money in there to take care of the meetings we'll have with the mediator and to also take care of the brief if the mediation fails.
Any questions?
So this is to do mediation. If we didn't do this, then it would end up going to court, I guess.
Yes, correct. The Fourth Circuit has set this program up. North Carolina Court of Appeals has the same type program. Hopefully you get the larger, more complex cases resolved, if they can be resolved, and take the burden off the court.
Through mediation.
Through mediation.
So this is basically a mandated procedure by the Fourth
Circuit. That has been so ordered.
Yes.
So will this terms of any settlement that's agreed to come before the county commissioners?
Of course, the county commissioners have to approve any settlement.
So is mediation binding, I guess, is to
if all parties agree, it is binding.
Okay.
So yeah, if we agree.
And then we have given our attorney explicit instructions on what the terms of settlement are.
Yeah. And we will represent us.
Well, Mr. Honeycutt will be the board's representative at the mediation, and Mr. Kitchen will
represent
the sheriff.
Our sheriff.
Right.
It's not really the county.
We have the checkbook. That's what we call
right. So you're not representing Mr. Honeycutt at the mediation?
No. Okay. He'll be the liaison between this board and the mediator, because mediations are confidential. Yeah. The rules do allow for a liaison to be there.
Okay. So you'll be our contact,
sir,
as to the information.
Yes,
from this.
The choosing of the legal counsel for the sheriff, is that your recommendation, or is that your choice, or is that the sheriff's, or a combination? Or
I think the sheriff and I both agree that it's probably good at this point to maintain that relationship.
Because if familiarity.
He's already been through the case.
Otherwise, we'd have to educate someone. And we've been involved in this case since 2007, and that would be quite a task to educate somebody.
8 years.
Yeah. Yes.
Let me go ahead and make a point.
Yes, sir.
I keep reading in the papers and hearing that Alamance County is not involved in this lawsuit, that it's all the sheriff is involved in this lawsuit, but Alamance County is the party in this lawsuit, and if we had lost, Alamance County would be footing the bill of several million dollars, probably a year. And
for the enforcement of the policy.
That needs to be known that the sheriff's department is a part of Alamance County, and the citizens of this county are the ones that have to pay. And I hope that our lawyers are very conservative in these negotiations. I don't see that we have to give anything, quite frankly, and if necessary, take it on up to the Court of Appeals in Richmond. I've sent many of them up there from here, and they're a lot more liberal now than they were when I was in Clyde's position, but still. And if we go appeal the judge's ruling on how much money we're supposed to get back, that's a good negotiating point with them. We won't ask for any more money from the DOJ, and we won't
go high and low.
But other than that, I understand they want to put monitors in the settlement. They want to put monitors in our sheriff's office. Now, you know how much that's going to cost?
That's expensive.
The monitors and the software, Judge, just those two items would have been well over $1 million.
Poor Rico is paying $1.5 million a year for monitors.
Monitor. In that respect, that would, I'm sure, with the sheriff, and you know, the fact that if it does go as mandated by the Fourth Circuit Court, the mediation, as they discuss this, that would be Mr. Kitchen and our sheriff would be making those decisions that would be brought back before Mr. Albright, who was then, and through Mr. Honeycutt, that would then be brought to the Board of Commissioners once they make a decision where we would be able to discuss what we feel like is right and wrong.
So well, the point I'm making is the negotiations, which I know are mandated by the Fourth Circuit.
Yes.
They started out with DOJ wanting to do exactly what the court of, in Greensboro or Winston-Salem told them they had no evidence to do.
Yeah.
There's somebody crazy up there. I don't know what in the world.
They won't find an ear that's willing to even listen to any of that stuff sitting on this board, I don't think.
I think that lunacy starts at the top.
Well, I'm concerned that we spend $35,000, you're up to it, and if we can't come to a settlement, then it's going to go to court, to appeals court.
That's
and,
correct.
And those legal fees, well, that we're going to end up spending probably as much as we spent on the trial to begin with.
That $35,000 includes the cost of briefing the appeal.
Right.
Which we feel like we've already got to do that.
I'm just hoping that we can find a settlement that will be reasonable for us, that it's not going to cost us an arm and a leg to
understand.
Implement whatever terms are agreed to.
Well, there was a mediation before the trial.
Yes.
And you could not get DOJ to agree to anything reasonably. I don't think you're going to get them to agree to anything reasonable now. Quite frankly, you might as well just face it. I think I told everybody, I told the sheriff himself, I didn't think we'd be fortunate if we got a dime back out of this case.
Yeah. Well,
it's just something we have to do.
The senators and representatives are working on a political solution to our attorney's fees, even as we speak. But you're right, a good summary appeared in the Washington Post about all of these cases. The reporter there went and looked at all of them, about 15 of them, to see how much is being spent by each city that is involved. And it's interesting because most of these monitors work for city police officers, very few for counties. And it's in the millions of dollars. Poor old Detroit was supposed to have a 5-year program, and they're still going on, but they're broke, so they can't pay for it.
And they Seattle would do that to us had that come in here, too. Well, so.
And the point of that article is that there's no measurable result.
That's because they usually win their cases. The difference is the sheriff won the case
yes.
in this respect.
And the difference is that DOJ has a whole lot more money in Alamance County, and usually the guy with the most money usually wins, but in this case,
well,
they did.
Sheriff that's won, so that's what set a precedent, and we're in uncharted waters, or they're in uncharted waters.
That was a mistake the DOJ made, thinking that we would roll over. But I think the judge made the right decision. I believe the Fourth Circuit will make the appropriate decision, too, if this mediation fails.
I've been behind the sheriff all the way on this because I was on the board back when we went, when they decided they were going to sue us, and I was one of the ones that said, yes, we need to fight this, and I'm going to give you a motion today that we need to continue on with what we need to do there in the mediation.
So I have a motion and a second. Any further discussion? All those in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Opposed, no. Thank you.
Thank you, and I hope you all have a Merry Christmas.
Thank you. Next, we have County Manager's Report.
do have a couple of quick things. We do want to talk about Health Department accreditation. Stacy wanted to give a quick update on that.
Do you want me to talk about?
Sure.
Yes, ma'am. Please do.
Disinfectant.
just don't touch anything.
I did want to just update you all that on December 11th, the Alamance County Health Department received reaccreditation status from the North Carolina Accreditation Board. And just to give special thanks to our accreditation coordinator, Ariana Lawrence, and our environmental health director, Carl Carroll, who has vast accreditation knowledge and helped us through that process. And also our community partners, the county management that participated in accreditation, county commissioners, and our Board of Health members who also did that. So we are reaccredited until 2019, when we'll go through the process again. So if you have any questions.
Thank you.
And appreciate the work that the Health Department
has done. We do. Thank you, Stacy.
And a quick update from Libby on our strategic plan. We have a website launch.
A website
yes.
launch.
Yes, I'm not going to touch that.
Thanks,
Glenn. I hope you feel better soon. But we did just launch the website for the strategic plan. Thank you to Scott and MIS for all their help. We're also going to launch a Facebook page just to make sure that we're reaching that segment of the population as well. And also an easy place for us to put out information. I put the flyer on your desk there that gives you the two dates that we've set for the large community forum. So that's February 12th at Elon and January 26th at Mebane. We tried to cover both ends of the county. And these are open public forums, and we hope that the public will come and participate as well as anyone else that would like to come along. We are coordinating with volunteer fire departments, or I guess I should just say fire departments across the county to have a series of public input sessions as well that would be coordinated by the planning department. And we have a number of community groups that will be holding their own forums as well. So we're moving along with
good.
Lots of different little parts moving around. We also have opened a strategic plan naming contest. So you'll start seeing the little slips around. We're going to be advertising that on the web page as well as the Facebook page with a prize for the winner. The libraries have been very kind to help us coordinate all of that, and I appreciate their efforts as well. And I think that's about it.
All right.
Well, I'd like to say I've been working closely with Libby, and she's doing a wonderful job at coordinating all this. I went to a facilitator's training program that was attended by, 20 or 30 county staff, excellent program, so that these individuals would be able to facilitate an input meeting.
Right.
That's good. And there's another one scheduled.
All departments, all across, a couple people from the sheriff's office. It's been really fantastic how many people we've had involved.
It's very impressive.
I think
impressive
there's a big interest in this.
Yeah, there is.
I mean, that's just what I hear from the public. We need their input.
We do.
As a board, no matter if we're not here next year, the county needs that to know how to move forward.
All right. Further questions? Thank you.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, one other quick thing.
Right.
I do want to recognize the Alamance County Public Library for their recent win for the Service Innovation Award for the Zoom Pass program launched in 2014. Offered library patrons the opportunity to check out free passes to local museums and organizations that provided information, education, or life skill opportunities. So a statewide recognition for our library, and I just wanted to quickly thank MJ and her staff for that. I'm getting what Clyde has. We will be closed on the 23rd, 24th, and 25th of this week. And I do want to wish everybody a Merry Christmas. Thank you.
Thank you. Merry Christmas. All right. Commissioners' comments.
I'd just like to report that we're making progress on our task force for dealing with the prevalence of mentally ill in our county jail. And I want to thank Susan for all the work that she's doing on that, and Mr. Britt from the Sheriff's Department. And we're breaking up. We've got four different people agreeing to chair four different subcommittees, each one dealing with a a certain aspect, a specific aspect of this project, and Tim Britt is one of those. So Sheriff, thank you for providing him. And but thank you, Susan. And we're going to have a meeting in January. I forget the date, January 16th or?
15th.
15th?
Mm-hmm.
And we'll have a guest speaker, hopefully.
Yes, from State Mental Health, who works on this project across the state of North Carolina.
And we have a group of about, I don't know, roughly 20 people on this task force, maybe?
Closer to 30.
Closer to 30, okay. It's growing. And we all have pretty copious assignments before our next meeting on January 15th. So we'll be reporting back as we make more progress.
Thank you. I just want to say thank you to all our county employees that work so hard throughout the year, and you guys, y'all do the job, and you get it done, and I just appreciate that. It's been a pleasure being back on the board for this past year, and look forward to 2016. I hear a lot of positive comments in our county, and I think a lot of those are the direct results of each one of you guys that work in our county. Y'all are helping to touch their lives in a better way, and I just want to say thank you and Merry Christmas.
Good. Oh, I've heard enough today.
Well, and I'd just like to echo Eddie's sentiments. I'd also like to thank Robin. This is her last meeting. Tori will be back tomorrow, and you have done an outstanding job with two beauties. And with that, I'd just like to wish everyone a Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And this meeting, unless there's any further business, this meeting is adjourned. Thank you.
Thank you for watching the Alamance County Commissioners meeting. Meetings of the Commissioners Board occur on the first and third Monday of each month in the Commissioners' Chambers on the second floor of the County Office Building, located at 124 West Elm Street in Graham. Typically, the first meeting of the month is held at 9 a.m., and the second meeting is held at 7 p.m. Changes to the meeting schedule will be posted on the Commissioners' website at www.alamance-nc.com. You can watch the most recent meeting of the Commissioners on the second and fourth Wednesday of each month on Time Warner's local public access channel, beginning at 10 p.m. You can also watch recordings of the most recent meeting and past meetings by going to our website at www.alamance-nc.com. Please visit our website for more information on watching Commissioner meetings online. For technical questions regarding this meeting's online or television broadcast, please contact our county webmaster at webmaster@alamance-nc.com. Please note that this address is for technical questions only. Questions or comments regarding the content of the Commissioners' meetings may be made to the Commissioners themselves. You can find their contact information on the Alamance County website at www.alamance-nc.com. Click on the link that says County Commissioners to visit the Commissioners' website, where you can learn about our Commissioners, read minutes of past meetings, access agendas, and find other information about our Board of Commissioners. You can also send mail correspondence to the County Commissioners by addressing it to the Alamance County Commissioners, 124 West Elm Street, Graham, North Carolina, 27253. Again, thank you for tuning in to the Alamance County Commissioners meeting.